I have heard you. I have heard all of you. I've seen what you have written about what you would like for me to go over. So we're going to go over it. This time is going to be over school finance. There have been some questions as to the expenditures or the bills, if you will, for different school districts. The first thing I want to show you is where you can find the data that I'm going to be talking about today. This is from the Kentucky Department of Education. And essentially, it is all of the reports that come from the district. They have them housed in one nice, neat, little, huge file. And the first one is the finance data. And the second one is the district personnel. So we'll talk about that a little bit too. Not very long, but just enough so that you can get an idea of it. The first page that you go to will look like this, and it'll say K-12 data, like it does down here at the bottom. And then once you click, once you scroll down and click at the bottom of there, you'll see this little thing here. It says research data. You'll click on there and it will go to the school report card data sets. So in other words, everything that they use to make the school report cards, that's going to be found on here. Now it'll have landing page highlighted, but what you can do is go over here to financial transparency and click on that. And then it'll take you to these right here. It'll have these two pop up. One's district finance. The other is school level spending per student. Now, I wanted to take a look at both of those. I focused primarily on the district finance, but I also wanted to bring in a bit of the school level spending so that you could understand what you may read, what you may be told, but why it may not be accurate. Okay. So the other website is the one that goes to the district personnel. And you'll see when this page pops up and you'll see school district personnel information. And then over here on certified and classified data, you can find all different kinds of data sets about how many total staff that are certified in all the different districts, the full-time employed certified teachers for any district. Minimum salaries, superintendent salaries, superintendent headcounts, whatever. You can find just about anything you want to in there. In fact, when I was working on my doctorate, I had a professor that actually said that there is so much data that Kentucky has that no one even looks at. So this is, I know it sounds stupid, but I kind of find this a little fun. So I have no problem doing it. Now, when I go to, I think I spliced this one together so it looks a little weird in the middle. But this is essentially all of the data for the first set that I downloaded. And when you click on it, you know, it'll download it automatically for you if you have it set up that way. So this is the data I'm working with. So I've had to go through it and aggregate a little bit of it, maybe hide some of the columns so that it doesn't get too confusing. And what I want to do is I want to take what is necessary out of all this that you all have asked me about, and put it together in such a format that you can understand it. I'm not going to go into the correlations or any ANOVA test or t-test or anything like that. Nothing that is like your research, your typical research that you would have done. This is going to be basically adding, subtracting, division, multiplication maybe, and some percentages. So this, anybody should be able to understand what I'm doing throughout this whole thing. So just because there's all these numbers, don't think that you're not going to understand it, because you are. I'm going to make sure that you understand it. This is for 172 districts. I think there's only 170 now because we had two independent districts close since this data came out. Now, just so you know, this is the 2018-19 data because it is the latest data that they have on KDE. So if you're looking for a certain year, you can find it on there, but this is the latest data that they have. So if you're looking for last year, this year, it's probably not going to come out until at the very earliest, probably next fall. All right. So here's what I've done. I have taken area schools from Fayette County to Science Hill, Madison, Laurel, Pulaski, Jessamine, Franklin, Nelson, Whitley, Anderson, Lincoln, Corbin, Russell, Rockcastle, Mercer, Taylor, Boyle, Garrett, Bardstown, Casey, Danville, Washington, Somerset, Berea, Frankfort, Williamsburg, Bergen, East Bernstadt, and Science Hill. Now, first of all, I had this just a nominal ranking from top to bottom of most, from the largest number to the least, of the membership right here. And you can see the general fund balance, you know, kind of goes along with the membership. You know, if the one is bigger, then the other is bigger, and so on and so forth. So first of all, Fayette County is the largest one we're talking about. Science Hill is the smallest one we're talking about. So we'll go on to the next one so you can get an idea of the different ways that I put them in order so you can see in the area who's spending the most, who's spending the least, so on and so forth. Here's the total expenditures. Of course, absolutely, Fayette County is going to have the most. You would expect that. There's nothing new there. And Science Hill has the least. I would expect that too. And I'll give you a second so that you can see over to the side. Not only do we have the total expenditures, we actually have here the expenditures per student and the SEEK allocation, or that's for the aggregated average daily attendance. So that's what that's for. That's how much they get for the ADA, the SEEK funds for ADA. So if you ever hear anybody talk about ADA, that's what they're talking about. It's the money that you get for the attendance of the students. So the next thing we have is the non-teaching certified staff. That's what I wanted to look at. Now, you're going to ask why. Here we have the full-time certified staff, okay? And then here we have the full-time certified staff that are teachers. You have certified staff that are teachers, administrators, counselors, something that needs a degree, something that has to go and be checked out through the Educational Professional Standards Board to make sure that you have all the requirements to have said job, okay? So if you take a look like at Science Hill, they have 31 total. Now, for certified teachers, they have 24, so that leaves a difference of 7. And that leaves the percentage of non-teachers at this. Okay, not a problem. But what I want you to understand is that Danville, having 31 total staff, 22.58% of their, that's Science Hill, for their teachers are non-teaching. They don't necessarily teach class. For a small school like that, I don't have any problem with that. I think that's just fine, because a lot of times, and in fact, in the case of Science Hill, and I'm going to give a shout out to Science Hill, because they have a principal that serves as their superintendent. So their superintendent and their principal are the same person. This guy could have hired somebody to be a principal, and he said, you know what, I could do it. What if I just did it all? Kudos to him. I think it is a fantastic thing he's done. But if you start looking down at the rest of it, you see that Danville is the second highest. They have 177.4 full-time certified staff, and only less than 139 of them are actually teachers. So if you take the differential, that means that there's 38.8 non-teaching certified people in the district. They don't teach a class. That means that 21.87% of them are non-teachers. They could be administrators, counselors, psychologists, whatever. So Danville's second on the list. Then you have Washington County. Now, I want you to remember that you saw Danville and Washington County here side by side. I want you to remember that later on. And then you have Frankfort, which has 20.24. Then you have Jessamine County, who's down here at 14.86. So they are not administrator heavy. These seem to be a little bit more administrative heavy. However, this one right here, I can kind of understand, and I explained why. If you look down, let's see, we have Boyle County that's right here at 19.81. Now, everyone has their reasons, and I'm not going to try to say what the reasons are. But if you look down at Pulaski County and Madison County, look at this. Here's Madison County. Here's Fayette County. Madison County. Madison County only has 15.31. Granted, it's a larger school, but it's not larger than Fayette County, and Fayette County's got 15.99. This, I think, is actually district preference. My question is, why is it preferred that way? And every district will have a different reasoning. I'm not saying it's good or bad. I'm just giving you the information and what I found to be interesting. That's all. So now that we have that, let's go on to the next one. So we have the average teacher salary. God love our teachers. I swear. It really rubs me the wrong way when I think about how little they're actually getting in their paychecks. So I've got these listed highest to lowest. And as you'll see, of course, Fayette County stopped the list. We figured that would be. Bardstown, wow. Science Hill, wow. Kudos to them. I think it's fantastic. And then you look Whitley, Mercer, Carbon, Washington, Franklin, Somerset, Laurel, East Bernstadt, then Nelson, Rockcastle, then there's Boyle. And then right under them is Danville Independent. So you see that Boyle and Danville are right here in the middle, okay? And then under that, you even have Madison County. Madison County, average teacher pay is less than Danville and Boyle. That threw me for a loop. I couldn't believe it. That just, I don't know, maybe they have young teachers. It could be explained any different way. But it kind of threw me for a loop. I couldn't believe it. I thought, well, okay, it's got to be something. Did they have a bunch of people retire the year before and they had new teachers come in? I don't know. It's just something to look at. But the next thing we're going to look at is this one right over here, which is the principal average pay. Of course, we have Fayette at the top. We figured that would happen. Jessamine, Bardstown, Franklin, then Danville. Now, let me refresh your memory. Back here is where Danville was for teachers. Okay, right here. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15th. And I think there's 22 on here. 15, 16, I think. Let me see. 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. Nope. 21, 22, 23, 24. So 28. Okay. So out of 28, they're about 15th. Okay. So we go here. Danville is 5th for average principal salary. And you can see the difference between the average teacher salary and the actual average principal salary. Then you go down here, Boyle County, here's the average teacher salary, average principal salary. Now, to tell you the truth, this is a better ratio than this. That's all I'll say. And of course, you look down at the end, Lincoln County, God love them. They're not paying their administrators too well, are they? Bless their hearts. Okay, so we've got the average teachers, our average principal salary, and we've looked at that in relation to average teacher salary. So we'll go on to the general fund balance and percentage. Now, what you'll see here is I have a district name, all the district names. Then I have how many students are in each district right here. And then we have what's called the general fund balance. And the general fund balance is how much they had at the reporting of this in the bank account. Let's just put it that way. Just say it's in the account, okay? That's what they had they could spend. Now over here, you see the general fund balance percentage. All right, let me explain that. If you think of your own banking account, and let's say that you have $1,000 in your banking account. You have $1,000 that you can spend on whatever you need to spend it on. And your bills for that month, you're going to have $1,000 in your checking account, bank account for the month to spend. And your bills for that month were $1,000. That means that your general fund balance percent would be 100%. That means you had enough in your checking account, bank account, whatever, to pay for the bills that month. So if you look at Somerset, they had enough to cover their expenditures and then some for the year. Okay. Boyle County was more along the lines of what's normal. Okay. So they had the general fund balance here. Now, I'll explain something else in a second. They had the general fund balance here, and it would cover 42.67% of the expenditures. Now, there's always money coming in and out from the state, from federal, so on and so forth. Excuse me. Now, what you've got to understand with Somerset is that it very well could be that they had some outlay that came into their balance before this was reported, and that's the reason they have over 100% here. They may have been they may have had it in the account for something that was coming up. So that's the reason this may be so large, okay? This is a little more average written through here. So you had Casey County, they had 36%, Washington 34%, on and on and on. So Boyle County was doing fairly well. Madison County, that was a larger county, they had 25%. Franklin had 25%. Laurel, Pulaski had about 19%. Fayette had 18%. And then we keep on going down and we see Danville. And they had 15.85%. So they were on the lower end in the area for how much they had left. Now, Frankfurt, now the opposite is true of Frankfurt that I'm not saying is true. Could be true. The opposite could be true of Frankfurt that was for Somerset. So if you look down at Frankfurt Independent, you see that the balance was 2.22%. It could be that they had just spent a great deal on an improvement or building something. Excuse me. So they might have had a depletion of funds. So we'll just keep that in mind. But we all know that Boyle County has been working on some improvements lately, and I'm not sure whether or not they were finished in 2019. I'm not overly familiar with Boyle County, so it's just to say that there could be reasonings as to why the percentages are this way. I'm not saying that one is great, one is terrible, whatever. I'm saying this is what I would normally see or I wouldn't normally see, and therefore it I'm going to let you make the decision. You'll see down at the bottom, excuse me, that the state average is about 21%. So that's out of the 172 districts that we had. Okay, so we'll keep on going with the assessments and taxes. This is kind of what made my eyebrows raise a bit. All right, so the first column we see here is the assessments. And then you see the assessments per pupil. And then the levied equivalent rate, then the tangible personal property tax, which there's some interesting stuff in there too, and then the real estate tax. Real estate, of course, you know, we just got done paying real estate taxes not too long ago. And living in Lincoln County, I knew exactly how it was, and I thought, well, you know, hopefully they spend it well, and they're good stewards of money. So I wasn't too worried about it. But it made me start thinking, what about everybody else in our area? Well, if you look at Frankfurt, you'll see that both their tangible personal property, you know, whether it be recreational vehicles or whatnot, and the real estate tax are both 96.5. Then Berea is at 95.2. Then Danville has two different ones. One is 95.5. The other is 94.6. Now, that makes me, that doesn't bring me any great consternation, you know, between the two. But it makes me wonder, why is it higher on one than it is the other? I'm sure they have a reason as to why. I'm just wondering if maybe the tangible taxes, they were thought, well, we need to do some sort of tax, but we don't want to put on the real estate to make everybody mad. And so I don't know. It could be any number of reasonings. Then you look down, and Fayette County is only 81 for real estate. Now, granted, they have 76 for tangible property, but they have 81 in real estate. Then keep going down, and Boyle County is 71.8. Now, why is it that it's so much more in Danville than it is in Boyle County? And you look down at the very bottom, and it's 42% in Rockcastle. So we know it can't go that low. Now, of course, Rockcastle is in a more of a rural area. But if you've seen some of their scores in the past few years, I haven't seen them in the past couple of years. But, you know, back a few years ago, their scores were pretty good. So they're doing something well when it comes to the allocation of their resources. They're doing something right. Bardstown, you see, is 87.3. And there's a huge jump between Danville and Bardstown. There's 11%. So I'll just let you take a moment and look through that. And I know somebody was asking about Somerset. And of course, you see Somerset 77.1. And then Pulaski is 55.7. Somebody was asking about that. So you have about 22. Yeah, about 22 is the difference between them, almost. 21.4, something like that. 21.4, something like that. All right, so I keep going on. And this is the stuff that they may not want me to tell you, but I'm going to tell you anyway. This is going to deal with expenditures per student, okay? And how much they spend per student in each school, and how it can be a little misleading. So first of all, we're going to start with the per pupil expenditures per school. So you see in the first four rows, you have Danville schools, and the second five, you have Boyle County. And you look over at what they consider to be per pupil spending per school. So you look over Danville Independent, like Bate, that had $13,000 per student. Danville High School had almost 14.5. Then you had Tolliver, which was 13, and Hogsett, which was 13. And it could be that they were spending more on the high school because they just done some construction with Tolliver. It could be any number of things. Then you look down at Boyle County, and of course, Boyle County Middle's getting 10.5. Boyle County High School is getting about 11. And then you look down at like Junction City and Parable. Now, Junction City and Parable, when I see those numbers, I'm thinking there may have been some upkeep work, some construction, some even beautification, if you will. There might have been something going on at those schools that required a little extra money for the year. That's not a big deal. Every school is going to go through that. Every school is going to have some reconstruction to it. They're going to have walls painted, something. You know, they're going to have something done with upkeep. So that doesn't really throw me for a loop. So, but here you have 13 to 14,000 when it comes to Danville, and you have anywhere from 10 to 14 down in Boyle County. So then we go past that and look at per pupil expenditures per district. Now, what I do here, and I'm going to show you here in a second how I do it. When you're talking about the district in its entirety, Danville and Boyle are at the top of everyone else in the area, including Fayette County, including Madison County, including Pulaski County. And you can see the total expenditures and the expenditures per pupil. And Danville has $20,000 per student, and Boyle County has 17. And you may say, Camille, how does that compute? I don't understand, because you just said over here, yeah, I did say it was different because those were per school. What else does a district spend money on that's not within a specific school? Ask yourself that. Make a list. So now that we have seen the expenditures per student, and we start with Danville up here at 20,000 per student, Boyle County at $17,000 per student. Now go all the way down here at the bottom. Oh, sorry, I knew that was going to happen. If you go down here at the bottom at Anderson County, it's a little over 11,000. That's in Anderson County, just up the road. And the state average expenditure per pupil, when you look at the total expenditures for the entire state and divide it by the entire number of students in the state of Kentucky, is going to be a little over $14,000. The same goes for everything else. If you take the entire amount of total expenditures for the district for the year and you divide it by the number of students in the entire district, these numbers under expenditures per pupil are what you get. Now let's see if I can explain a little further. Well, I had to throw this one in there. This one was just a side note. You're going to look over here at and see where the percentages lie. Okay, and you have the general balance, the general fund balance. This is not expenditures. This is the general fund balance. And I just wanted you to see sort of how this relates to this, relates to this, relates to this. Now, what's this last one? This last one is the number of superintendents for the district. That's all I'm going to say. No, I take it back. there's one more thing I'm going to say. Fayette County says one. That is not correct. I don't know where the state data came up with one. But I know there's many more than that. And I'm wondering if there's like five, I think. But I do know that they have like a little bit of a different structure when it comes to their central office staff. And I'm thinking they had, if I can remember correctly, that they have directors of curriculum, director of this, director of that. And then they also have, they have directors over certain areas of schools. Like they'll have the one high school and then the surrounding middle and elementaries. So you might have five directors, one for each high school. And then they've also got the feeder programs of the middle school and the elementary schools. So I know that's skewed a bit. I know that's not exactly correct for Fayette County. So you might want to just cross off Fayette County. But everything else, I think, is pretty much on par with what I remember. Now, remember why I told you I wanted you to remember that Danville and Washington were next to each other? I want you to look on this list, and I want you to look at Danville and what they've got. Then I want you to look at Washington and what they've got. How do the numbers compare from here to here? Just keep that in mind. Okay, next. This is where I start really getting into breaking everything down. And they don't want you to know this. So we go back to the original breakdown of what the state has put out. As far as, okay, here's the Danville Independent Schools. Here's all the different schools. Here was the total as reported to them for per student for each school. That averages out to about 13,512. Okay, I just did an average of it. Then you look down at Boyle County. Here it was for each school. And then I did an average of it. So here per student per school is 13,500. Here per student per school is 12,300. That doesn't cause me a lot of alarm. When you go over here, you'll see that I have actually multiplied this times the number of students in the district. So this times this equals this. So this total per student times the total in the district equals this. So this is how much the expenditures were for those students. Okay. Now, when you look at what I had up here, is it here? No. When you go down, what I had before for the district expenditures per student total. Now, this is for the district, not just for the schools. This is for the schools. This is for these schools. This is for the entire district per student. This is for the entire district per student. This one's Danville. This one's Boyle. Entire district per student. The difference between this per student for the schools per student and this per student for district is $6,571 per student. When you go down here, this was per student per school. This one is per student for district. This is the difference, which is $4,718 per student for the district. When you take the total number of students and multiply that by the difference between the school per student and the district per student, here's what you come up with, $12 million. For Boyle County, when you take the number of students and multiply the difference between the building average per student expenditures and the district, the difference being 4,000, 2616 times 4718 is $12,341,000. That's not too far from each other, is it? Now tell me why. And if you can tell me why, I'm happy to listen. I don't care who you are. I don't care who you work with. If you can give me an idea as to how to explain this, please do. Because here you have almost 800 fewer students than here. This may be, what, 80% of what's down here? Does that sound right? So why are these nearly the same? Now, the next part I want to talk to you about. If you took this and this, and you did the average between the two school districts, it'd be $18,552. I wonder if anyone in Boyle County has thought about how their average would increase. I don't know if they have or not. The last time that I spoke to the superintendent at Boyle County, I spoke, I think, to him and the assistant superintendent about a possibility of charter schools, you know, and I said something to him that I didn't know that I didn't think the Danville would probably last, you know, another 10 years. And he said that every time that they have an open meeting of some sort, somebody is asking him when Danville is going to merge with Boyle. And he said to me that he told them, and I think he was honest with it, he said, that's not up to me. That's up to Danville. I just wonder if Danville's thinking about it. Now, if we go past this, now let's say if this were a perfect world, and we did have charter schools and vouchers. Okay, I'm sort of veering off here. I have now proven what is being spent per KDE. This is not me just pulling numbers out of thin air. This is all the calculations are done with data from KDE, as reported to them by the districts. What if we were to have charter schools? And what if we were to have vouchers? What could the funding look like? I love this part so much. If you were to do parent choice with a voucher system where students have the money following them, okay? And you were to do any one of these with parent choice. You have the voucher system, you could do charter schools, you could do pod learning, you could do homeschool with a certified teacher, and this would be competitive. So instead of saying we have Boyle County, Danville, Lincoln, Mercer, Gary, if there were several students that had a connection of some sort, let's say in Lancaster, let's say that you had parents that lived in Boyle, Danville, Lincoln, Mercer, Casey, whatever, Jessamine, Fayette, and they all worked in Lancaster. No longer do their students have to go to all of those different districts. They can actually come with their parents to their place of work or around their place of work, and it could be just 10 kids. Well, if one teacher, now I know this is pie in the sky, and I realize that this is probably not realistic, but what if you had one teacher, certified teacher, could teach whatever you needed, or even if you had just first through fifth graders or third through fifth graders for 10 kids, 10, that's it. If you had 10 students and per student, you were to get the voucher for the average of what Danville and Boyle County had. Now, granted, they were two of the highest, but let's say somebody actually came to Lincoln County and 10, there was a few parents that worked in Lincoln County, but they were getting the vouchers because they had their students living in Boyle County, okay? And let's say that they got $18,552 per student. That teacher could take $185,000 for 10 students. 10. and take that and possibly hire one or two more people to help them out with those 10 students. They could fix lunch for them, bring in lunch, have a different schedule. They could even bring in a fine arts teacher once a week and maybe pay them a little. A teacher could take $185,000, take $100,000 of it for themselves. Let's just play that role. Let's just play that what if. $100,000 for themselves per year for 10 students and still have $85,515 left over for the needs of those students, whether they wanted to bring in somebody that did music, somebody that did visual art, someone that, I don't know, worked on weight training, anything. Sorry, my dog is snoring. I don't know if you can hear it or not. But if they could do anything with that $85,000. Do you know any teachers that would do that? I sure do. Okay, so now let's see. If you were to go a little bit larger and say that you were to be able to find, as a teacher, a place that could house 100 students, okay? Now, we're not talking about having a gymnasium and having this and having, not the all the frills that students in sports would need. That's a totally different topic. That's a totally different situation. We're talking about the main core content areas. We're talking about math, English, science, social studies, reading. That's what we're talking about, the main components. I'm a music teacher, so don't get mad at me, those of you who are fine arts teachers, because you can do this too. Because with my school, if it ever comes to pass, it will be a fine arts charter school or a fine arts pod learning academy. And they would all be competitive if you did a co-op of 5 teachers, okay? And you did 100 students. Because here you see where I've also got it for 25 students for one teacher. Because many teachers can say, hey, I've had to do 30 and 40 students. I think I could do 25. If they did 25 at 18,552, look at that number. Look at that number. And with that, even if you kept 200,000 and you were a teacher / administrator, you wouldn't even have to be a principal. You could have $263,788 to do whatever your heart desired or whatever your parents felt like they wanted their kids to do. Shoot, for that price, no lie, I could have every one of these students taking piano, violin, and another instrument. I could have them learn 3 instruments, each and every single one of them, for about $75,000 a year. Yep. And that's if somebody has, well, that's if they're getting paid $25 per half hour lesson. And most people, if you put them on salary, wouldn't even ask for that much. All right, so now if we went down to a co-op, let's say we had 5 teachers that were really good and they wanted to come together and do it themselves because they felt that they could do it better than the districts do. And they wanted to put a little co-op together. And they had 5 teachers with 100 students at $18,000 per student. Look at that figure. And what if those 5 decided, we're only going to take, you know, at most, if you, with health benefits and putting money aside for, I don't know, lawyer expenses and so on and so forth, we could do it with our own, you know, if we each had $200,000 a year. If they were paid $200,000 a year, that would be $1 million. It would still leave $855,150 for the other 100 students. And you may be asking, well, what about athletics? Okay, instead of having it solidly in place where if you live in this part of the district or in this part of the state, you have to go to this school and therefore you have to be on the athletic teams at this school, you do a co-op. So then for all the area counties and municipalities and so on, you have different leagues, okay? And let's say you have League A, League B, League C, and League D. You have 4 different leagues. And League C had the best coach. Everybody wants to get in the League C. Well, A, B, C, and D all compete against each other regularly. C has got the best coach and therefore is probably a little more competitive with getting the best players. Well, that may spark some competition with League B. And then you're thinking, okay, we've got to get my kids on League B, and therefore I want to make sure we have the best coach. See, what you've got to understand is that takes athletics and makes it, and even music too, it takes athletics, music, everything, and puts it on the outskirts where it's not necessarily tied directly to any specific school. So you can have kids from school X and school Y be on a team together at League C or League B because they have the freedom to go wherever. There can also be, the reason they get into the sticky situation is that you have one particular school or one particular district paying one particular coach. But if you have something where it's a co-op and a school joins in with an athletic co-op or league or something and say, you know what, we'd like to help sponsor you all. And then you have this entire league that you sponsor and the kids can go to any one of those coaches instead of just one coach. You're going to find that you're going to have better coaches that want to stay around longer and you're going to have better training for the kids. You think I'm kidding? Let me do the experiment and I promise you I could show you. And not only that, every one of these schools, if you had a co-op or if you have a charter school or pod school that has an influx in and out of students, they like the teacher, they don't like the teacher, they want to do something else, these teachers are going to wind up becoming incredibly competitive and wanting to do the absolute best by the students. Because for everyone that they lose, they'll lose this much. That's funding and all. So why wouldn't they want to make sure that their students are doing the absolute best? Are you certain? I hope and pray that you're starting to see where I'm coming from. And I've had so many people tell me, well, teachers hate charter schools. Yeah, because it hasn't been explained to them exactly what could happen if we said, let's disband public schools over a span of time and go toward a more student-centered learning base. I want you all to think about that. And now maybe you all understand, after having said all this, why it is that districts are not crazy about me being a part of their work, even though I could make it 100 times better. Now let me bring this back down a little bit so I can show you kind of my thoughts. Here are my thoughts. Teachers are not compensated well. There is an overspending in areas not directly related to student education. I have shown you that. And I think if we were to see exactly where it went, of course, you know, I understand facilities and so on, but I think there's a little bit too much pork fat in the spending than many people know about. And lastly, I really do believe that there's an educational revolution that is necessary in order to return to a neoclassical style of education. And what do you mean neoclassical style? Along the lines of what you were seeing in the one-room schoolhouse. That's what I'm talking about. A neoclassical idea. It's just bring a new spin on that classical idea of the whole John Dewey situation where you had the one-room schoolhouses and the singing schools and so on and so forth. You had these local areas getting together for football games, and you could just have tons of leagues, and it would be more of a free society with it. That way we could focus on the real world student learning in an ever-changing world and teaching students how to find the truth, not just because we as teachers are telling them they have to believe it, but because they're doing the research and finding out that it is so. That's what we need to get back to. I realize this could be as mind shaking as being told that, you know, something about Area 51 is true. I don't know. I realize that it can be a little more than people want to comprehend, more than they want to think about. But this is the type of stuff I think about all the time. How can we improve what we're doing in schools? And I'm not getting a dime for it. So, if you all have any questions, if you have any thoughts, feel free to contact me. You can do it on Facebook. I know Larry's already touted my name a few times. So just, you know, click on my name, send me a message, friend me, go to Freedom of Education on Facebook, whatever you'd like, and we can have some real conversations. I hope that this has been somewhat informative, and I hope that you understand that we've got to do something. Because as long as darkness wants to hold on to darkness, you'll only have darkness. We've got to get some light to come in. So that's all I have to say for the day. The next time I'll look at just independent schools. This was the area schools. Next time it will be just the independent schools. I hope you all have a wonderful day, and be mindful of each other, and be mindful of what you learn. Y'all have a great day. I think that's so-